Good afternoon. Thanks for joining us today at our seminar on trolling techniques. We hope that you learn a lot over the course of the next couple of hours. My name's Paul Birdsey. I work for the Division of Wildlife Resources as the Coldwater Sport Fish Coordinator. Those of you who may have seen the announcement for this meeting may be expecting Drew Cushing, our new Aquatic Section Chief, to be standing here. Unfortunately, he had another commitment that he couldn't get out of, so you got the second string today. I'll do my best. Lee Rasmussen, our with our Blue Ribbon Fisheries Advisory Committee, has been very instrumental in putting these things together, and we really appreciate his work. And he asked me to spend a few minutes today talking about the status of Utah's fisheries. And specifically, he's been getting a lot of feedback, I guess, from anglers that are concerned with all the publicity that we've been doing lately with tiger muskie stocking, walleye stocking, hybrid striped bass stocking, et cetera, that we've forgotten about trout and salmon. Fact is that we don't. We haven't. Our hatcheries last year produced about 1.2 million pounds of trout, which were stocked into Utah's waters. Most of those were rainbow. And you may have seen recently that over the last year, we've been expanding our kokanee salmon program. We've stocked them into Electric Lake 3 years ago, into Smith and Morehouse on the Uintas also 3 years ago. Fish Lake, we started those in 2015, I believe. We also stocked them into Starvation Reservoir this year and into Jordanelle this year. So we are really trying to expand that program. And why have we done that? Well, because the anglers have said that they won't. That's a species that they're very interested in catching. So we're trying real hard to respond to what the anglers ask us. Now, that being said, y'all need to remember that we live in a desert. There's only a limited amount of water. We are the second driest state of the nation. We do not have the opportunity to have 500 different waters with kokanee salmon in them, or, you know, 1,000 waters with tiger muskie in them, whatever. We simply don't have the water. We also have an expanding population. We're one of the fastest growing states in the nation with regard to our population. I'm not a native Utahn. I was born in the East. I moved out here almost 40 years ago. And when I moved here, there was about 900,000 people in this state. We just this year rolled, you know, over 3 million residents in this state. And by the next 15 years, that is expected to get close to doubling again. It's going to be close to 5 million people. And that puts a tremendous amount of pressure on our natural resources, including water. So the Division of Wildlife Resources does, I think, you know, from an unbiased perspective, I think we do an excellent job with managing with what's given to us in terms of water. We also, part of that expanding population and the demand on waters means we get greater fluctuations in our reservoirs than we may have historically. We've been in a drought for much of the last 10 years. Those of you who may have been to Jordanelle Reservoir in the last 3 years and standing at the top of the boat ramp, it's a long way to the water. I mean, it's a good quarter mile to the water from the top of the boat ramp. It's down around 100 feet. And the other thing that happens there is that our water quality has gotten, you know, as reservoirs aged, water quality in the reservoirs gets a little bit worse than it was before when the reservoir was built. They're not as productive, but they tend to silt in a little bit more, and the habitat may or may not any longer be suitable for trout. About 20 years ago, the Division of Wildlife Resources gave up on trying to manage trout in Pine View Reservoir. When I first started working for the division, we stocked trout in there every year, and they failed every year. There may be more instances when that will be the case moving forward, that the water quality in the reservoir is not sufficient to sustain trout. Now that, with regard to other recreational activities on the water, probably not. There is some evidence that, you know, two cycle boat motors put oil into the water, leak gas into the water. That obviously has an impact. But motors that were built after about 2000 do not have that same level of problem. I have a two cycle motor on my boat. Many of our national parks or national recreation areas do not allow older two-cycle motors on the water because of that reason. My boat has no problem getting on. I just have to show my registration because it's a cleaner burning. The number of people probably doesn't have an impact. And not to be too crude about it, assuming that they use the appropriate facilities. Okay, but it's just the way reservoirs are. They get older, they don't get as productive. So at least their water quality changes so that they're no longer suitable for trout. Now, I want to emphasize that that is only for the reservoirs that are between about 5,000 feet in elevation and about 6,500 feet in elevation. Reservoirs higher than that, guess what? They're going to stay cold. They're going to stay good for trout and salmon all year long. So do we have a more balanced fisheries management program than we did 37 years ago when I started working for the division? Absolutely. Are we any less committed to managing with our traditional species of rainbow trout, etc.? Not in the least. If we were, I wouldn't have a job, because that's my job, is to manage those waters. Okay? So are there any other questions about what direction we're going with management? Yes, sir. Why don't we stock wipers and walleye in there? Right now, because nobody's asked for them, in part. Okay, you have to deal, I'll tell you all right now, the way that you get species added to your favorite water is that you start with the regional fisheries program manager. They will then talk to you. They will evaluate the value of it. We will identify whether, sorry, you're the only one in the state of Utah who wants walleye in Pine View, so therefore we're not going to do it. And then they'll also evaluate the biology of the reservoir to see whether it's appropriate for it. I will tell you right now, my impression of Pine View is that it's rolling along really good, and that we probably don't want to, you know, upset the apple cart, because you don't fix what's not broken. We did put wipers into East Canyon Reservoir a year ago, because we wanted to try and use them for a management tool there, and they'll probably do just fine. So in terms of, do you have the opportunity to fish for wipers in a nearby location? Absolutely. So, yep, Willard, East Canyon, other places. Other questions about what direction we're going? Yes, sir. Yeah, okay, so we asked about quagga mussel in Lake Powell. And what the species is, it's called the red ear sunfish. It's also known in the south as a shell cracker. They feed on snails. That's what their primary forage is. They have them in Lake Havasu, and It's called the red ear sunfish. It's also called the shell cracker from the south. But I want you all to know that there is no way that red ear sunfish will control the number of quagga mussels in Lake Powell. A single female quagga mussel produces over 1 million young per year. Okay, so that's not what the purpose of us looking at stocking red ear sunfish into Lake Powell is at all. The purpose is that what typically happens when you have quagga mussels is they filter all the plankton out of the water, and so there's nothing for other fish to eat. So what we're trying to do is to put something in there that will create an alternate energy pathway in that reservoir. So now the quagga mussels will take all the plankton out of the water. It's tied up in quagga mussel biomass. There won't be anything left for bluegill or crappie or those other forage fish that are currently in the reservoir. So what do? You put in a forage fish that eats quagga mussel. And so you go from quagga mussel to red ear sunfish to walleye to smallmouth bass. That's the way that energy pathway is going to flow, rather than from, you know, bluegill and crappie and shad. The stripers, they're going to probably not do as well in the future. So, does that answer your question, sir? Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, red ear sunfish will eat quagga mussel. The current world record came out of Lake Havasu 2 years ago. I want to say it was 5 pounds. It's a pretty chunky sunfish. Yes, sir. We had a positive finding a year ago. It's been sampled a whole bunch of times since then. We have not had another positive sample, but according to the law, we have to go 3 years before it can be downlisted and no longer be what is considered a suspect water. So that's where we're at right now. We're basically into year one of what we hope is a 3-year process of getting them downlisted, or it downlisted. Yes, sir. Not in the state of Utah. The other quagga mussel infested waters, there are no other ones in the state of Utah, but all the reservoirs in the lower Colorado Basin, Havasu, Powell, Lake Mead, they all have quagga mussel. There are a number of other waters throughout the, especially east, that have quagga mussel in them. So, okay, you can get a list off of the website that's called stdofthesea.com. And you can get all the information that you need to know about quagga and zebra mussels and where they're located and what the proper procedure is for your boats. Okay? One more question. Yes, sir. Is there a question of whether they can travel up the Colorado? Yes. They can't swim, okay? But if they did happen to get into some slack water, got established, then they could gradually move their way up. Or more than likely is that they're going to have some help from a boat. That's the easiest way for them to move. They moved, you know, 95 miles up Lake Powell in the space of a year. And when we started to ask ourselves why that happened, we found out that it's a standard practice for the houseboat concessionaire to move boats between locations. So those quagga mussel got a free ride up lake. Okay, I'm going to turn it over now to you up next, Marty, to Marty. He's going to talk about sonar. Those of you who may have seen our attended our walleye seminar here a few weeks ago know that Marty knows his stuff about sonar. So thanks, Marty.
All right, can you guys all hear me? Okay, perfect. All right, so yeah, like I said, my name is Marty Burt. I'm one of the fishing managers at Shills. I've worked there for a couple of years now. I grew up in Duchesne, Utah. If you've ever been to Duchesne, you'll know that a lot of people there fish. It's either because there's nothing to do or because it's good fishing. So let you decide which one. So today we're going to talk about sonar and how to use sonar for trolling. So I looked at the DWR stocking report last year, and at Strawberry Reservoir, assuming my math is correct, they stocked over 1.5 million fish in Strawberry. So there's tons of fish there to catch. If you've ever been to Strawberry, you will know that it's a pretty big reservoir. There's a lot of surface area on it. I'm sure you could go there, you could troll without using that trunk. You'll probably hook up on a couple of fish. But what I want to do here is help you guys understand how to use sonar, how to use the electronics that are available to you to help you find the fish and catch more fish. So we're going to go over different sonar types. We're going to go over sonar, chirp, down imaging, and side imaging, understanding what those are and how to use those to catch more trout and more kokanee. We're going to go over networking capabilities as far as networking units together and units to trolling motors and how to utilize that. And at the end, we're going to talk about some different units and some of the abilities of them. So first of all, to help you understand the difference between trolling and casting, some of the different concepts so that we can go forward and talk more about how to use units specifically for trolling. So when you're trolling, you're covering more water, whereas with casting, you're often fishing specific locations, whether it's structure, whether it's points. Trolling, you're just covering water. Trolling, you're fishing behind you, your lure's behind you. Casting, oftentimes you're casting in front of you, you're casting to where you haven't been yet. When you're trolling, your lure is going to pass more fish. Casting, you're more focused on presentation to specific fish. Trolling, you're searching for more aggressive fish. Again, casting, you're trying to catch any of the fish in the given area. So understanding that, we're going to start off with 2D sonar. 2D sonar is going to be your greatest tool for marking fish and finding fish. So the definition of it is it's a system for the detection of objects underwater and for measuring the water's depth by emitting sound pulses and detecting or measuring their return after being reflected. So what that means, you have a transducer on the end of your boat. It's a hockey puck looking thing. It's going to shoot down sound. If there's anything in the water column below that boat, it's going to reflect off of it and it's going to portray it on your screen. Like I said, it's the greatest tool for locating fish. So kind of a little diagram of it. Again, transducer is going to be on the back of your boat. It's the very top of that cone you see there. That's going to be where your transducer is located. Like I said, it emits sound pulses. It travels down in a cone shape. So the deeper the water is, the more water you're going to be covering with that sonar. It bounces back when it hits anything in the water column, whether it's a fish. If you have your sensitivity up, it could reflect off little pieces of algae, little pieces of grass floating around. And then once it receives that noise back, it portrays it onto your sonar screen. So, it looks simple enough, but if you see that screen there on the left, it can be fairly complicated when there's a lot of stuff in the water. So here we're going to try and help you understand what you're seeing when you're looking at your screen. So there on the far right of that screen, you have that vertical bar with horizontal lines going through that. What that is that's the RTS window or the real-time sonar. So whenever your boat's going over something, it's shooting that sound down and it's reflected back, what it picks up is displayed on that screen there. So you see that screen, there's a bunch of horizontal lines. That could be picking up some fish, it could be some dirt in the water, but anything that it picks up is going to be displayed in that screen. And then the bulk of the screen there on the left, where you got, your humps and your arches and your big blobs in there, that's all history of your RTS window. That's all history of what you've already passed over. So again, for trolling, that screen is going to be something you're going to use mostly. You're going to be looking for patterns. You're going to be looking for fish. You're going to be looking for structure. You're going to be looking, you know, for a patternable depth. Maybe the fish are holding at 20 or 25 feet. And you're going to be using this screen to locate those fish and try and get your lure to where they're at. You can see your top and the bottom of the water column. You're always going to have a bunch of noise on the top. That's not fish. That's just disturbance in the water caused by your boat. And then your bottom should always be a pretty solid line, so you know where your bottom is and what the depth is. So when you're trolling, when you're going over water, what you're going to be looking for fish are going to show up as arcs. You see there, you got a bunch of fish arcs. Those are going to be fish. They're not going to show up as a little fish symbol. You're going to be looking for those arcs. And the little diagram on the right explains why it shows up as an arc. So you got your cone going across. The fish might be 13 feet deep. When he first swims into the arc, he's going to be 14 feet away from your transducer because it's coming down at an angle. So he's going to show up as a little line at 14 feet. As he swims into the transducer or into the cone and his whole body gets in there, the arc's going to get thicker because he's fully in the cone. It's going to come up a little bit because he's closer to the transducer. And then as he swims out, it's going to get thin and drop down again. So when you're looking for fish, look for these arcs. That's how they're going to show up on your fish finder. So there's two main beams that you're going to be using with 2D sonar. I want to kind of go over the difference between the two so that you know when it's appropriate to use either one. So you have an 83 kilohertz and a 200 kilohertz. So the 83 is the wider kind of brownish beam you see up there. What the 83 is going to do, it's going to be wider. You're going to see more fish. So again, if you're trolling, you're trying to develop a pattern, you're trying to figure out how deep the fish are, using that 83 kilohertz can allow you to see more of the water, see more of the fish, and help you figure that out. The 200 kilohertz can be narrower. It's going to show you better detail along drop-offs, along rock points. You're not going to see as many fish, but it's going to show you detail in that more kind of rugged area. So I want to talk a little about chirp sonar and the difference between it and just your standard 2D. So chirp sonar alternates frequencies from low to high, providing you the benefit of more detail with a higher frequency and the benefit of seeing more of the water column with a lower frequency simultaneously. So if you think of the different frequencies as wavelengths as they're portrayed here, normally you're either stuck at a 200, which you see on the top left, or an 83 kilohertz beam, which you see on the top right. Now if you're using 2D sonar, you either have one or the other, and that's it. What chirp does, usually you're gonna be using high chirp, medium chirp, low chirp, or a combination of two of the three. But what it does is it alternates frequency. So instead of being stuck on just 83 or just 200, you can now alternate from 140 to 200, or from 83 to 120. So what that's gonna do, you're getting the best of both worlds of the 83 and the 200. You're gonna see more water column, you're gonna be able to mark more fish. But those times where you're going off of ridges, you're going over rock piles, you're going over submerged trees, you're gonna have that better detail as well to see those fish, where normally with a higher degree beam, you wouldn't be able to see them. This is another good example of 83, 200, and chirp, and where they're all useful. So example of you coming off of a drop-off. The 83 kilohertz, with it being a wider beam, it's gonna get more return on the top of that drop-off, so you're gonna be missing all that fish in that slack water right off of it. You're not gonna be able to see it. A 200 degree beam, you're gonna be able to see those fish off that drop-off, but you're not gonna be able to see as much of the water, so if the fish is off to the side, you're gonna miss them. You're not gonna be able to see what depth they're at. Using chirp, again, it alternates between those two frequencies, so you're gonna be able to see the fish off the drop-off and the fish off to the side. So chirp is a pretty good tool, especially places like, say, Flaming Gorge, where you're fishing kokanee, and sometimes they may be holding right next to those ledges out there, that old riverbed that's in the middle. They might be holding close to that. Sometimes your 83 degree beam might not be able to see them because I'm going to be picking up the ledge. Your 200 degree beam, you might miss it because you're not covering as much water. So using chirp as a perfect example of being able to locate more fish. So this is a screen between 2D sonar and chirp. Your 2D sonar is going to be on the right, your chirp's going to be on the left. Biggest thing is target separation. There on the left, you can see more defined fish arcs, and you can see more of the arcs. There on the right, they kind of more blend together. So that's another example of where, chirp's gonna be more beneficial for you. Here's another example. You got that big ridge right in the middle there, and you can see some fish holding off of it. Your normal 83 kilohertz beam, you'd most likely miss those fish. You wouldn't see that they were there. You know, with that chirp, you're gonna mark those fish. So I'll talk a little about down imaging. Down imaging's widely used in the bass market, but it does have some applications for people who are trolling. So the detailed images of down imaging are created with high frequency sound waves. So with sonar, you're talking 83 to 200 kilohertz. Down imaging frequencies, you're talking between 455 and 800 kilohertz. So much more powerful beams. So these high frequency sound waves are emitted in ultra thin slices. The sonar returns from these waves produce a snapshot of what's below your boat. What's that? Speed for down imaging? Mm-hmm. Yep. As long as you, what's going to determine that? He talked about how well is down imaging going to work at higher speeds over, say, 5 miles an hour. As long as you have your transducer mounted correctly, you can get those detailed pictures up to 40 miles an hour. We've been on boats going that fast where you're able to get still a detailed picture. But it all is going to determine on how level your transducer is mounted. So up here you can kind of see what the beams look like. So your two cone shapes in the middle are going to be your standard sonar. Those kind of oblong ones, those thinner, more oval-shaped ones, that's going to be your imaging. So it's able to provide more detailed pictures. So here's an example of 2D sonar with down imaging to the side. So if you can see that sonar to the left, you know, you might guess that that's a bush. You might guess maybe that's a big ball of bait fish. You know, what is that? Looking at the down imaging, you can see it's a tree. I don't want to troll through that or I'm going to lose my setup. So down imaging for trolling is best used with your sonar to clarify what you're seeing. Side imaging is, I think, one of the best tools, you know, with the exception of 2D sonar, for locating fish. And structure scan. Hummingbird calls it side imaging. Lorenz calls it structure scan, but it all amounts to the same thing. So side imaging structure scan uses the same thin cone angles down imaging, but shoots it out at a wider angle, giving you a detailed picture of the structure of the bottom as far out as 360 feet to the left and to the right of your boat. So that's a picture of side imaging. I'm going to kind of go over it because it can be kind of confusing of what you're seeing there, but we're going to go over it so you know what you're seeing. First thing to understand is boat location. So you've got your line running right down the middle of the screen. That's where your boat has been. That line where it meets the top of the screen is where your boat's at now. So everything you're seeing is what's behind you. That black line, that black section that goes down the middle, that's the water column directly below your boat. Where the lighter portion starts, that's the bottom of the lake directly below your boat. And then the white going out to the left is the water, or the bottom of the lake to the left of your boat. The white going to the right is the bottom lake going to your right. So you're able to see structure to the left and to the right. You can see out on the left side of the screen where it's kind of the same in color and it slowly gets darker. That's going to be your flat terrain. So it's just a big flat out to the left of your boat. Descending terrain on the bottom right, you can see some darker lines. That's descending. That's going to be like the bottom of ridges or the backside of ridges. Rising terrain, you got real, just to the left of that, those dark lines, you got real light lines. That's a ridge ascending. And then other objects, you can see bushes and trees. So where side imaging is really useful is you're able to see structure out to the left and to the right, and you can actually see schools of fish out to the left and to the right. So again, picture yourself, you're trolling a strawberry, you're trying to catch some kokanee. They tend to school up. With side imaging, you can see those schools to 100 feet out to the left of you, or to the 100 feet out to the right of you. With traditional 2D sonar with down imaging, you're only seeing what's directly below your boat. But with that side imaging, you can see them, okay, they're 100 feet out to the right, that's where I need to be. I need to go over there, and that's where the fish are at. As well as, let's say you're consistently catching fish off of points. You can see there where the arrow points, there's a point there. With side imaging, you can actually scroll over to there, mark a waypoint, and where that point's at, it's going to show up on your map. So now you can cruise over 100 feet to the right of where you were, you'll be trolling right over that point. So side imaging is an awesome tool to be able to see more of the water and to be able to effectively fish it. So I'll talk a little bit about some specific sonar units that you guys can pick up that's going to do some of these. Oh, I've got a question. Yes, so usually you'll buy the unit that's set up for side imaging, and it's going to come with that specific transducer. So usually if it says it can do side imaging, it's going to do side imaging. But yes, it does require a different transducer, different crystal in that transducer. So a couple of the units that are that I want to go over, we're going to be kind of focusing more on hummingbirds, and I'll kind of show you why. Lowrance still makes good units, but we're going to kind of focus more on hummingbirds today. So their entry-level units are the Helix 5. They vary from $100 to $500 depending on which unit you want to get. They start off with just sonar for $200. You add the GPS for an extra $100. You add sonar, GPS, and down imaging for $350. And then you gain side imaging for up to $500. So, you know, they've got a bunch of price points. You know, you figure out what you need, they'll have a unit there for you to pick up. Helix 5 has a 5-inch screen as well. Jump up to the Helix 7, same thing as the Helix 5, just going to be a little bit bigger screen. But you can still get the sonar GPS, the down imaging with sonar, and the side imaging with down imaging and sonar. The Helix 5 and the Helix 7 are standalone units. They're not going to connect to anything else. And we're going to talk a little bit more about networking in a minute. So the Helix 9, this is where the hummingbird units are starting to be able to link with each other, to network with each other. So again, they're a little bit more expensive. You're looking at $700 for the sonar GPS versus $300 at the Helix 5. It is a bigger screen, it is a 9-inch screen. $800 for the down imaging unit and $1,000 for the side imaging unit. Something else unique about these Helix 9 units is they have AutoChart Live built in. What AutoChart Live is, it's the ability to chart your own maps. So if you go to a lake that, you know, doesn't have any maps published for it, maybe some of our smaller ones, something like, you know, Deer Creek may not have maps published for it. You can just cruise over the lake a couple times with this unit and it'll actually make your own detailed map. Helix 12, the Helix 12, biggest difference with it has chirp built in. So all the Helix 12 units are going to have that chirp ability. The sonar, just the sonar basic model starts at $1,700. The side imaging is $2,300. So big differences with the 12-inch screen, ability to network again, and it has chart built in. No, so for instance, if you buy the side imaging, it's going to do down imaging, it's going to do sonar, it's going to do GPS. If you buy the down imaging unit, it's not going to do side imaging, but it'll do everything else. You can't, because, so he's asking is, if you buy a down imaging, can you add side imaging later? You can, but you have to buy a new transducer for it, a whole new transducer, because the down imaging transducer doesn't have the ability to do side imaging. So it's cheaper to buy it with all the features you want than to add it on later. So let's talk a little about networking capabilities and what you can do if you have a couple units on your boat. So here's an example. Let's say you have a fish finder at the console of your boat and then one at the back where your downriggers are at, so you can see what's going on when you're back there. So here's an example of a Helix 9 side imaging and a Helix 9 sonar that are linked together. So when you link them together, that Helix 9 sonar will now run off this Helix 9 side imaging transducer, and you'll be able to, that Helix 9 sonar will now do everything the Helix 9 side imaging will do. So instead of, you know, if you want side imaging at your console and at the back of your boat, you don't have to buy two $1,000 units. You can buy a $1,000 unit and a $700 unit, save yourself $300, and the one on the back will link with the one on the front, and they will share all those features. It depends how old it is, but yes. Some of the older models won't, just because there's not enough computing software. But if it's like an 800 series you bought within the last 2 years, it will. Yep. Other capabilities, something called iPilot Link. So this is a pretty big feature for anyone trolling, anyone jigging, anyone fishing, you know, at all. So Minn Kota makes a couple motors. They make the Ulterra and the Tarova that will link up with the Helix 9 and Helix 12 units. So what that'll do is your fish finder is essentially going to drive your trolling motor. So going back to that side imaging, you saw that point over to the right. Let's say you want to troll over that. You can go over there, click on it, say, go to this spot. Your fish finder is going to talk to your troll motor. It's going to turn and take you right to that spot. So for trolling, other options you can do with this, let's say you're catching fish in 20 feet deep. You can go to your fish finder and say, I want to troll 20 feet deep. And it's going to take you exactly 20 feet deep all the way around the lake. So the ability to hook your fish finder up to your troll motor and able to fish, you know, specific locations is a phenomenal tool that you have. It only works with specific motors. The Ulterra and the Trover are the only two motors that's going to work with. But it is an awesome tool. So, you know, a lot of people there's a guy at my Flaming Gorge that I helped set up his boat, and he had this setup right here. This is what he did. So he had the Helix 12 Chirp at his console. He had a Helix 9 in the front of his boat and a Helix 9 in the back of his boat. He's able to link all those units together and then hook it to a trolling motor. So he's able to have side imaging on the front, on the back, and at the console of his boat. And was able to run his trolling motor off of it. So, you know, the ability to network, the ability to have the boat essentially drive itself is going to help you catch more fish. So a lot of people who are just trolling all day long, they don't want to run their, because the Minn Kota troll motors are electric. They're not wanting to run their electric motor the entire day. So a little tip that you can do if you have this set up, if you have a kicker on the back, little troll motor back there pushing you along, you can have that troll motor on front set on the lowest power, and all that's going to do is steer your boat while your kicker in the back pushes your boat. So you can still troll all day long without using up your batteries, but still have that accuracy that you're getting with the GPS. You can run it, so you asked, with the three units if they'll run off of one transducer or multiple transducers. You know, generally they run off one transducer. A lot of times your troll motors will have a transducer built into it as well that you can run off that transducer. But it's usually beneficial to run off just the single transducer in the back. Reason being, the picture's not going to be different from one transducer from the left to the right of your boat. You're going to be seeing the same images. It's where it benefits is if you're in the back working, you know, running your downriggers, it's going to be hard to see, you know, that screen up at the console. So having one back there that you can see while you're running your downriggers is beneficial. And you can see what depth the fish is at without having to constantly run up, you know, to the front of your boat. As well as if you hook a fish in the back of the, you know, you're downrigging, you hook a fish, you're back there trying to get it off, you can hit mark on that GPS there so you know where you caught your fish, instead of having to reel it all the way and then run up and hit mark, and then, you know, you're off that spot by then. So, another question. It is. So any of the transducers can be built into the trolling motor is just going to be 2D sonar. Reasons being, in order to run that imaging, the noise from the transducer, you can't run imaging with it very clearly without a lot of extra insulation. So yes, it's just going to be 2D sonar transducer that's on the motors. Any more questions? One way in the back there. So color screen versus black and white, the biggest advantage is going to be you're going to be able to see more what the transducer is telling you. So if you think about it, let's say you got a Blu-ray player and you hook up to a black and white screen. It's not doing anything extra for you. Having a color screen, having a high def TV hooked with a Blu-ray player, you're really able to see all the information that it's given you. So you saw a bunch of different colors up on those sonar screens. You saw greens and reds and different shades of yellows and light greens. That's going to be hardness. So if you're going across the lake and you got a bunch of greens on the bottom, there's probably going to be a lot of weed on the bottom or grass. If it's a dark red line, It's rock. It's going to be hard. If you have black and white or grayscale, it's pretty tough to differentiate what you're seeing. You just see marks. But, you know, having the colors, you're able to get more information to the screen to interpret it. If it's suspended, you know, most likely it's a fish. It could be something else floating in the water. The question was, if you have a big... So big suspending blob, you're seeing different colors. Something hardness in the blob. It could be a big school bait fish. They're more concentrated in the middle, so it'd give a more positive return. It'd be more red. The outside could be yellow. It could be a stick with some moss floating on it. But yeah, one more question here. Yes, it will. Question: will it show thermoclines? Yes. I'm gonna do one more. So trade-off between hummingbird and Lowrance, quality between the two. The biggest thing with hummingbird is how easy they are to network. So hummingbird, you can network units together, you can network it to motors. It's a lot easier and a lot cheaper to do that. Lowrance can do it. It's just going to be more expensive to get into it. As far as the actual imaging itself, Lowrance does have a little bit better of a sonar. Hummingbird sonar does great, but Lowrance's is a little bit better, a little bit more detailed. Their chirp's gonna be a little bit better than hummingbird is. Hummingbird's imaging's gonna be a little bit better than Lowrance's. They have about the best imaging on the market. They're both phenomenal units for the money. If you don't plan on networking at all, Lowrance is gonna be a little bit better of a unit. They do have some similarly priced units. But if you do plan on networking, plan on hooking a couple units together, hummingbird's definitely a better way to go. Yeah, so thank you guys for coming out. I enjoy doing these things, and that's all I got, so thank you.
Thanks, Marty. Yeah, this is interesting. I was telling Marty before the seminar that when I started using sonars for work, they were paper charts, and if you wanted to, you know, count how many fish or whatever, you actually sat there with a pin and put a little mark through the arc on the paper. So all this stuff is pretty amazing to me. We're going to have Scott Tolentino come up. Scott's our biologist at Bear Lake. He's been there for 24 years now, Scott?
Yep.
Scott, actually, I was up at Bear Lake for a while, and Scott followed me up there, so it's been a while. So we'll get this started and turn the time over to Scott.
Well, thanks, and glad to see everybody turn out this morning. Well, this afternoon, I guess it is, but... like Paul said, I've been up at Bear Lake for the majority of my career. I served a little bit down here in Salt Lake, but that was early on, and learned to really like Bear Lake. But once I'm away from Bear Lake, I like to fish too. And so anyways, it's the difference between fishing for work using nets and fishing with a rod and reel. And to me, it's a huge difference. And one is work and one is play. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about trolling methods, and I'm going to try to cover some different techniques that I've learned over the years. And there's a couple of things I might have left out in this talk, but be free to answer any questions while we're going along. So we talked a little bit about the different types of trolling motors. And if you're going to troll, you're going to need a motor. And so we have different kinds of motors. The gas-powered ones, or people call them kickers or trolling motors. You know, you can pick up some used ones on like KSL or something like that, or you can go brand new. Anywhere from about 5 to 15 horsepower will just about troll any size boat. And so you could spend as much or as little as you want. In this picture, and in the upper right-hand side, I have a picture of the back of my boat where I have a main motor, and then I have a small trolling motor off to the side, and I just have a simple little bar that connects them, and I could drive it right from the console. I don't have a huge boat, and it works out that way. Some of these trolling motors that you could hook up on the back of your boat, you could put these remote trolls or different versions of that where you can steer that motor with a wireless little clicker in your hand, and that works pretty nice. But for me, I kind of prefer simple, and there's a lot less problems to deal with sometimes, especially when we're trolling in some cold weather at Bear Lake. Batteries like to go dead and everything else. So when you got a steering wheel hooked directly to it, you don't have to worry about it as much. There's a lot of people out there right now trolling electric trolling motors. You can either mount them on the front or the rear of your boat. Have one, two, or even three batteries. Some of these can put out as much horsepower as about 4 or 5 horsepower, almost the same as a gas-powered motor. And so it just depends on what kind of boat you have and what kind of setup you're after. But both of them work effectively, and you could spend as little or as much as you want to on them. So I'm going to talk a little bit about lures, and up here in the front I have laid out several different types of trolling lures, and during the break or whatever, you guys are feel free to come up and look at them. But when you're selecting lures for trolling, it's more than just opening your box and grabbing something. You need to consider several different things. Looking at the lure profile, whether it's fat or thin or long or short or whatever, you got to think about what kind of fish you're fishing for and what that particular fish is eating. And if you have any kind of idea what they're eating, like say cutthroat trout or lake trout at Bear Lake are going to be eating Cisco or whitefish. If you go to Flaming Gorge, these kokanee are going to be going after dodgers and squids, and there's a great display in the back of the room with dodgers and squids on it. And so I'm just gonna even really cover that. Please take a look at the displays. Another thing that's really important, especially at Bear Lake, but on other waters in particular, is whether that lure makes a sound or not. Some of them, there's no sound, just plain old wooden Rapalas is a good example of something that's a quiet lure. Other ones, they have BBs or rattles or just about any kind of other noisemaker in them. Some even have some kind of a battery inside of them, and when the lure gets wet itself, it emits a clicking sound. And so, again, these lures can be anywhere from about $2 or $3 up to $30 per lure. And like I said, it's all a matter of personal preference, but you always got to think about the species of fish that you're targeting. And then on these lures, hook sizes to me is very important. A lot of times I will take the standard lure out of my tackle box and I will either upsize or downsize the hook. Most of the time I'm upsizing the hook because some of these lures, like Rapalas and small crankbaits, they're made for bass fishermen. That's where they make their money. But we're targeting a lot of cold water fish here in Utah, and some of them arguably quite big. You know, at Flaming Gorge we're talking lake trout up to 40 pounds, or even at Bear Lake up to 20 pound lake trout, and these big, you know, 7 to 10 pound cutthroat too. They can straighten out some of the lures that straighten out some of the hooks that come on these lures that are standard. So I'll go up to some of these what they call 2x or 3x hooks on there that are a little bit extra strong, and they don't bend as easy. And then one of the things that is, I think, most important, and it kind of goes along what we heard again with sonar, is having that sonar or some way to tell what kind of speed you're going. It's great when you could drop your lure in off to the side of your boat and adjust your motor and get the right action for that particular lure. A flatfish is going to, you know, require something maybe about 1.5 to 1.8 miles an hour to make it run nice. And if you get over 2 miles an hour, that flatfish is just going to spin and it's not going to go. Rapalas are going to be a little bit different, some kind of minnow lure. I mean, you're going to troll those in anywhere from 2 miles an hour up to 4 miles an hour. And so it's great when you can see it next to the boat, but as soon as the wind picks up, whether it's a headwind or a sidewind or a backwind, you could be either going faster or slower. So that's where it helps to have that GPS that's built into your sonar, or even have a little handheld GPS on your boat so you can know the accurate speed of that boat regardless of what the wind's doing to you, to keep that lure running at the optimum action that you want it to be. So I talked a little bit about what are the fish eating and how do we size that lure. And so I put a couple pictures of fish up here, three different pictures. There's a sculpin on the top and a whitefish and a Cisco. And depending on the time of the year, you're going to want to target a fish and use the lure that is most likely to be what that fish is feeding on, and you'll probably have a lot better luck. That works about probably 80% of the time, and the other 20% of the time, you could put something huge on when they're eating something small, and it just triggers it. So it pays to not stick with what you always know catches fish. So if you're not catching fish out there, experiment around a little bit. Don't be afraid to switch lures and speeds and depths. And so these three different lures, you know, three different sizes in relation to that prey fish size are sometimes very important. Right now at Bear Lake, they're sculp and spawning. Okay, there we go. It's back on. Anyways, we were able to use a smaller lure for those sculpin. When they're feeding on Cisco in the middle of the summertime, upsize that lure and have it reflect an accurate thing. Now, on these other waters where you know, we're targeting rainbows or whatever, you can try a whole bunch of different types of lures and you'll have the hopefully the same results. As long as you have an idea of what they're feeding on, you'll have a better chance at catching fish. We talk a little bit about how these lures run, and so on these, I just put a bunch of different lures on here, but if you look at the bill on that lure, the little lip on them, we need to know if you're going to be trolling flat lines behind your boat, say you don't have downriggers, you're going to want a lure that's going to be in the zone where most of those fish are. So again, using your sonar like we heard, looking for those fish arcs, and then using the type of lure that's going to get right into that zone, whether you know you're right underneath the surface, are these fish coming up and feeding off the surface, you're going to want something that runs shallow, have a very small lip, and then as it gets deeper and deeper, you can adjust these. Some of these lures, and I have one of them up here, they can run over 30 feet down, and there's a book out there, this Trolling Bible it's called, and there's different versions of it. It's, gosh, it's up to like version 15. If you could find one in print, you're going to pay dearly for it. They're very hard to find. You have to watch the auction websites and try to find one, but they're wonderful things. A lot of them are electronic now for people with smartphones or some kind of way to access it. You can look on there and it tells you, if I want to fish at 22 feet and with a Rapala that's a J11 or something, it'll tell you how much line to put out, at what pound test and what speed, and it'll show you exactly where it is. And that book is really important to have. I keep a copy on my, have a general idea. I use a lot of different lures, but I kind of get into the same routine as a lot of people. And so I know what lures with what line type. Trolling speed, again, that's going to make a lure, if going to run shallower or deeper depending on how fast you're going. And then most importantly is line diameter. And so I'll start right now. I know I'll probably catch a lot of flack from either somebody here in the room or I'm sure online, but I troll everything right now with the super lines, the braided lines. The thinner diameter lets that lure run deeper, it's easier to feel, and I use my rod to eliminate the stretch, and I'm going to talk about that line here in a minute. And then the length of the line is really important. Putting a flat line or surface line right behind your boat, sometimes if you're fishing for an aggressive fish, say like tiger muskie, and you're trolling for them, you could run something right literally in the prop wash behind the boat, 10 or 15 feet behind the boat, and those fish will actually come up and see what all the commotion is. But when you're fishing for a more finicky fish like a walleye or even wiper, say out in Willard Bay and you're trolling, if you're in some shallow areas or cutthroat trout right now on some of our cold water reservoirs, they're in right along the shorelines feeding. And so you don't need a downrigger. You can run these flat lines, but they're shy. So when a boat crosses, those fish spread out away from your boat. And a lot of times, if you don't have the line far enough back, before those fish end up moving back into where they were, your lures have already passed through that zone. So you're trolling in a big, you know, big abyss, so to speak, around your boat. So don't be afraid to let out your line sometime 150, 175 feet behind your boat. And with a super line that doesn't stretch, a braided line, that makes it easy, because without that stretch, you could really put the line back far and you don't have to worry about so much stretch that you're not going to be able to hook a fish. The different lip configurations on lures is probably one of the biggest innovations in the last few years that have come out. Again, it started with the bass fishermen, but that's translated to all the different species, whether it's cold water or a cool water fish like walleye or northern pike or muskie, just about anything. So you have these lips that are either shaped like a scoop, some of them are just square lips, and then in the bottom left-hand corner here, I just kind of showing the different lip configurations, and that's just one site off the internet where I stole some of these pictures from. And all those, I guess there's arguments for and against all those different type of lips, but whatever kind of running action you want, some of these give it a very erratic action, some of them just barely a wiggle. Again, it's going to be depending on the fish, so I guess what I'm saying is try to have a good selection of different lures in your box, and once you find one that's out there that's working, stick with it. We have the ability to fish with two lines here in Utah, so if you're fishing by yourself, try something different on the rods and just keep messing around until you find something that's going to work. And once you find that, then you can switch both lures to that, and that's typically what I'm doing out there on the water. So this line types, I put it up there. You can compare it to the Ford, Chevy, and Dodge argument. Which one's better? So you got super lines versus basically monofilament. And so there's a bunch of different super lines. I just named some of them here. Spider cord, spider wire, rip cord, Power Pro, Super Braid, Gorilla Braid, Bully Braid. There's all kind of different lines out there. And there's pluses and minuses for all of them. But here's some of the pros and cons of the super lines. And so, and the pros, very thin diameter. You know, you could have 30-pound test that's, you know, in a super line that's equal to 7 or 8, maybe 8 or 9 pound test, less than 10-pound test for sure on a monofilament when you're comparing it. These super lines are very long casting. So when you're casting, you can cast them a country mile literally with the same type of lure. And that thin diameter translates to very low resistance in the water. So when you're trolling with a long line flat behind your boat, the thin diameter, say if you're saying a 20 pound test braided line, that's probably equal to about 6 pound test monofilament. And so that line's gonna cut down through the water. And so that lure, when it's diving, the resistance is gonna be so little, it's gonna be able to get there. I have a question in the back. I'm going to talk a little bit about lead core line. The question was, what about lead core line? And I'm going to cover that here in just a second. So the question was, is do I put a monofilament leader when I'm fishing with the braided line? And the answer is I do. I run about a 6 foot piece just because it's highly invisible. The braided lines are, that's I guess one of their drawbacks. It's very easy to see them in the water. So if there's any question of whether that fish can see that lure, I always run a piece of fluorocarbon or monofilament about 6 feet. And I just tie a knot, or you could tie a swivel in case you're, say, trolling a spoon and you don't want it to twist up your braided line. One more question in the back. Yep. So the question was what kind of knot am I tying the super line to the braid? And so you could type that in on any kind of browser online, and there's going to be about 10 different answers. And so I tie a Albright knot. It's a double Albright, actually. And so I'm tying that one. You can look those up. It's fairly easy to tie once you do it. The knot cinches up really tight, and it's very, I have never had any slippage. I don't put any super glue on my lines or anything like that, and I've never, ever had one fail. And so, but there's a bunch of different knots out there if you type like braid to monofilament knot, and you're gonna get probably 7,000 or 8,000 hits of different answers. But the Albright knot is a really good one, and it's used both for salt water and fresh water. And it works really good because it's a very thin diameter knot, even a thinner than a blood knot. And it doesn't slip, and it goes right through your line guides on your rod, so you don't have to worry. So when you have that piece of monofilament, you don't have to leave 6 foot of line hanging and holding your rod up in one hand and trying to net the fish with it. You could reel right down to it. And so very rarely do I use a swivel unless I'm trolling spoons or something that's gonna spin. I tie it directly on. Another pro of the super lines is the excellent feel. Probably more oriented towards jigging, but I also like it when you're running lures. If you run a lure, say 150 feet behind your boat on a flat line, just directly behind the boat, it's so far back there, And say if I have a flatfish on, that flatfish is moving, and a lot of times you could see your rod tip just kind of vibrating. But when it's back that far on monofilament, the stretch in the monofilament, your rod is just bent. You can't tell if that flatfish is back there spinning or not having the action. With a super braid, you could see that rod tip pumping, and you know that you've got good action. And so that feel is what I'm talking about right there. Another thing is these super braids are really long lasting. I remember when the first version, the very first version of Spiderwire came out in 1992, and I thought I was crazy when I laid down like $30 and bought 100-yard spool of that stuff, and it's bad enough now, but back in 1992, $30, it's probably equal to $50 or more now, and I laid that money out. I will let you know I'm still using that line, and I still cannot pop it. And this is the first year I started with the state of Utah, and I'm still using that same spider wire. And so it's not like monofilament. It doesn't deteriorate with the sun, and it lasts forever. And then I have a no stretch thing, and I have a little star by that because it's a both a pro and a con of this line. There's a lot of argument out there that when you're trolling with a super line, especially on a softmouth fish like kokanee salmon, is that going to rip hooks out of the line or rip hooks out of the mouth of that fish using that really non-stretching line? And again, that kind of goes back to the Ford Chevy Dodge argument. I say no way. I've had a much better success. I have a very limber trolling rod. This is a 8-foot 6-inch rod. It has super line on it with about a 6-foot leader. It's a downrigger rod, so it's made for downrigging. It's very limber. It's very slow action, which means it just bends gradually. That takes up a lot of that shock when you're trolling with super line. So I trust my reel's drag, and I trust my action of the rod. Now, if you're going to be trying to troll with a downrigger using a 5-foot rod that's fairly fast action, which means it's very stiff except for the tip, sure, you're probably going to rip some line out. But if you are serious about trolling, get some trolling rods that are different from your regular casting or jigging rods, and I can guarantee you that super line is not going to be ripping lures out of the kokanee's mouth. That first initial hit from the kokanee is kind of pretty violent, and same thing with cutthroat and lake trout of any size, but it'll just rip out of that downrigger release, and then you're fighting that fish with this, and that's where you're going to either have problems with pulling out. If you got a really stiff rod, you're going to pull lures out of the fish's mouth, but if you have a limber rod like this and let the rod take up that initial surges on any of the runs of that fish or jumps, then the rod's going to do its work, and so is the reel's drag. And so I can't stress that enough to have some fairly quality equipment. As far as cons of the super line, sometimes people say it's too limp, and it's kind of a pain sometimes. You know, after you get a fish in and you're trying to reset your downrigger, the line tends to wrap around the tip of your rod because it's so limp. I've just kind of learned to deal with it. It is a drawback, but I'd still rather use it than not use it. Another thing is the line is very abrasive. So when you have ceramic guides on your rod, if you're reeling in and out 125, 150 feet of line every time, it's going to score your rod guides on here, the line guides. And so these new line guides that are on most rods now that are, I don't know what they're made out of, titanium or some kind of metal that's super strong, it doesn't wear. The old ones that have the big ceramic line things, yeah, you'll see little scores in there. So again, another negative is sometimes it cuts into the spool. So when you have a spooled up, if you got your drag set really tight and you're fighting a fish that you got it really tied down and you don't want that fish to run for some reason, and you're trying, it will cut down in itself. And so the next time when you're letting out, it's going to be very tough. You're going to have to pull it out. That is just a con of it, and I don't know how really to get around it. And then again, I have that no stretch. Some people view it as a real negative, and I really don't. And then one of the other things that come up, and someone pointed out to me, they say super lines do not hold in the pinched downrigger releases or if you're using planer boards, and I'm going to cover that. If you get the right kind of release, it's a non-issue, and that's all I'll say. If you get the right kind of release, it's going to be it's going to work just as well as any other thing. So So the different kinds of trolling. On these, I'm going to have a series of four pictures. There's two of them here. Flat line, there's a little scale in the bottom. It goes from simple to complex. It's the most simple way to troll. You basically just let out line behind your boat, and you use the different types of lure lips to get down to the depth you want. It's cheap. It's an easy way to go. It doesn't cost anything. Anybody can do this. Then I've mentioned lead core. Lead core is the same type of a line that we have, same type of fishing where you let the line out behind your boat, but the line that you have on the reel is filled with a lead core. And so lead core line is typically marked in about 10 yard increments. So every 30 feet there's a different color. And so you could kind of judge, if you don't have a line counter reel, how far out. And again, I mentioned this trolling Bible. If you don't have the trolling Bible, you could look and you could say, how many colors do I need to let out of lead? So you could say, okay, I need to let out four colors with this particular lure at this speed, and I know I'm going to be fishing, say, at 25 feet down. Yes? Precision trolling. That's the name of the trolling Bible. So, yep. And like I said, it's you can Google it. And like I said, there's a lot of people, if you're serious about it, it has a wealth of information in there. But lead core line, again, I'm using a fairly stiff rod, but I'm also using a piece of either fluorocarbon or monofilament leader attached to the lead core. I typically do run a swivel on lead core line between the line and the leader. It's nice. If you have a small boat, or say a float tube or a little pontoon boat, and there's no way to attach a downrigger and you want to get down deep to troll, this is the way to go. You can get down to easily to 60 or 70 feet if you have enough lead core on here. So typically use a fairly large reel that holds a lot of line, and there's different weights of lead core. And so the heavier the poundage on lead core, that means the heavier the lead that's in there, so you can let out less line. And again, you know, you're not trying to make this line invisible. It's very thick, but it's just a method to get that lure down to the target zone of where those fish are. Yeah, make sure you don't get a bird's nest when you're using these bait casters. You'll learn very quickly after one or two that you keep your thumb on the reel. But again, on the scale that's shown on this picture, from simple to complex, it's pretty simple. It's very easy trolling. You don't need a lot of special equipment. In fact, no special equipment. You just got your line, just like anything else. Then the next complex level is downriggers. You got your downrigger up mounted on your boat. You're running it down to a big cannonball, and then right at the cannonball you can have a line release. So when your line is hooked down to that release and then run back to your lure. And I'm going to show some other pictures here in just a second. If you've never done this before, I know there's a lot of people in here that are probably better trollers than me, and there's some people that may have never fished before, so I have to kind of cover all the bases. And so this is a way to get down to deep holding fish, especially on deeper cold water lakes, Flaming Gorge, the Soldier Creek side of Strawberry Reservoir, Bear Lake, anywhere where you got these deep holding fish, especially in the warmer water months. When the thermocline sets up, most of those fish are down at least 60 feet or deeper. And so it's an easy way to get that lure down there without a lot of fuss. And then I guess the most complex way of trolling is trolling with planer boards. And planer boards, they allow you to get the lines off to the side of your boat rather than down deep. And you could use planer boards with lead core line, which I've seen done, and that way the lead core can get it down a little bit deeper. But most of the time you're using planer boards with just regular line, and these boards run off to the side of your boat. And there's several different kinds of planer boards, and I'm going to cover those right here next. I just wanted to kind of mention these. So going back to the downriggers, again, if you have money, the stores will find a way for you to spend it. And so you have everything from very simple clamp on manual downriggers, then to manual ones where you put a base on the boat and then the actual downrigger just kind of clamps onto it. That's the middle one showing there. And then you have the electric ones where I swore I would never have an electric downrigger on my boat. Now I have one, and I love it. And when you have a busy day on the water, and you're up and down all day, I call it downrigger Olympics, where you're winding that cannonball back and forth, especially if you're by yourself. So you're trying to drive, watch your GPS, wind up downriggers. It's so nice to be able to flip a switch and have that cannonball come up when you're fighting a fish. But I just kind of grabbed a menagerie of pictures off the internet. There's no way I'm endorsing any particular brand, whether it's talking about lures or downriggers or releases, and so I just wanted to make that clear. Downrigger weights, you're gonna need something big, and these downrigger weights, they come in various configurations. I have several of them up here, so if you wanna look at them afterwards, but they have the regular cannonball, which is usually just a round weight with a couple clips. The top little clip, that one runs up to your downrigger on your boat, and then the one behind goes to a release. Then they have the pancake weights, which are nice. Those are the ones I prefer. I actually make my own pancake weights, and they're very compact. They're flat laterally, and so they cut through the water. And so when you're trolling, especially if you're trolling a little bit faster, to have the downrigger ball swing back behind the boat, you might not be able to see those downrigger balls in your cone of your transducer. And I like to keep a track of where those are in relation to the bottom, especially in a rocky area, because you don't want to hang one up because they're fairly costly. And so the pancake weights will track very close to straight down under your boat, regardless of the speed, where a round ball going through the water has a lot more resistance, so it tends to blow back. Then they have fish-shaped downrigger weights. Some of them have the ability to put scent in them. I have one of those up here where you can inject scent into the actual fish-shaped weight, and it trickles out through a little wick on the bottom of it, and there's just all kind of different variations on those, and the prices can be a lot of difference. One of the things I did want to mention was the weight of these. If you can get away with it, go with the heaviest ball that you can, because those balls will track right underneath you. It's easier to see them on there. It keeps it more stable. You're not having to have downrigger balls swing back. And when the downriggers are hanging straight down below your boat, when you're making a corner, you don't have to worry about a downrigger cable getting caught up in your trolling motors. And so a lot of people say, well, I troll with 6 pounds. Well, my pancake weights are about 12 to 13 pounds. And I wish I can get them a little heavier, actually. And so as long as your downrigger can handle it. Now, the little clamp-on downriggers, they might only be able to handle, you know, 6 or 7 pound weights, and that's fine. I mean, but if you can get away with it, go with the heaviest weight that you have. So is there any way to get rid of the hum in the downrigger wire? And the answer is yes and no. The when I say yes, is you can get rid of the hum by eliminating the wire and using one of the super lines. These super lines, they're made for downriggers now, and so they don't hum, and that's really nice. However, a lot of these downriggers, they have especially electric downriggers, they have the electric battery in them, and they put into a like Canon, I think it's called positive ion control, and it's supposed to emit electricity into the water, and they use that metal downrigger line to transmit that down to your downrigger weight. And so without using a metal line, you don't have that positive ion control. And whether or not that works or not, you know, Canon says it does, but I don't know, other companies might argue that. And so yeah, you can get rid of the hum, but you have to change lines. And so it's just depending on the speed. So that line is vibrating. If anybody's been here and trolling with downriggers, you have the downrigger hum in your brain the rest of the day, and so anyways, it's kind of annoying sometimes, and other times you really don't notice it. And downrigger releases, I brought several downrigger releases in, and there's all kind of different ones, and every company again claims theirs is the best. And so I'll just give you some of my opinion. And I showed some different ones here in the pictures. Some are mechanical releases, like this Chamberlain release in the middle and the one in the lower left-hand corner. The other ones are these types where you pinch them. If you pinch it, you just stick your line in the middle. There's different sizes. there's a big one, a medium one, and a small one. And since I troll with Superline pretty much exclusively, I have found that the bigger the downrigger release, the easier it is to control how much tension it takes to release and how much loading on your rod you can do. And so on a big release, it has a lot more surface area. You can see the surface area difference between those two. It's magnitudes difference. And so I really don't like small releases because it's very difficult to get that line set in there for different species. If you're happy with just one setting, that's fine. But on these bigger releases, it has this little black line across there. Sometimes I insert it all the way past the black line, sometimes up to the black line, or sometimes I barely get it in the pincher. So if I'm fishing for smaller fish and I want it to release, I'll just barely get the line in there. With this, you don't have that ability to do that because it's so tiny. And so I'll put in a plug for the big releases. I don't care what brand they are, but the bigger ones are easier to adjust, I think, in general. And one of the complaints is the releases don't hold Superline, and these big releases, they definitely hold Superline, and they hold it really well. And so when you're trolling out there with your downrigger release, you want this rod. You don't want it to be just a little bit. I have these rods really bent over and loaded up. And what I mean by loaded is this is running down there, and I like my rod to be bent at least this far. And if you can get it, the harder the bend, the better, I think, because when a fish does hit and it pulls it out of the release, you have all that extra whip to help set the hook. And when you're fishing with a Superline with no stretch, it works out really nice because you get that initial hit, it pops out of the release, and then your rod sets the hook, and then you could just grab it and tighten up and fight it. And so I see a lot of people out there trolling with very short rods. The rod isn't even bent over, and they're relying on, I guess, the fish to hit that lure and hook itself, or they hurry up after it does release and try to wind up the slack line, and they set the hook. But by that time, a lot of times the fish is gone. And so I believe in really making the rods bent over so they load up on you. So this is your typical setup where you have your downrigger ball connected to a release. Your fishing line, where it's labeled on here, that goes back to your lure. The one that's going vertical, that goes up to the boat. And so when the fish hits, it pops it out of there. You're kind of moving along. There's ways to troll more than one line on one downrigger, and that works good, especially if you have three or four people on your boat and say everybody wants a rod. So you have your downrigger ball, which is shown on the bottom of this picture, and you have your release, and that's where the fish is attached. Then you have what they call stacker releases. And so there's a bunch of different types of stacker releases out there. Some automatically slide down. Others, after you set your bottom release, then you drop the ball down about 10 feet or 15 feet, and then you can attach another clip right onto the main line. And it snaps on there, and then you have the release going off. Then you can hook another lure, then you can drop them down. This shows three different rods off of one downrigger. That's about the maximum you want to run, because if you get a hookup sometimes and you get a tangle, tangle in three is bad, but if you have a couple downriggers, that's six. And I see a lot of people out there with four downriggers, and you multiply that times, that's 12 lines, and it could be you know, it can ruin your day. So this is an example of what I would think of as a loaded rod. It shows the rod really arched over. This is a very slow action rod. This picture's off the internet again, but the arch is really a long, slow rod where it's totally bent over. So when that fish goes, you probably have 6 feet of whip from that rod that's gonna whip up and try to set that hook. And so that's what I talk about when I'm talking about a loaded rod. Now, on the planer boards. Planer boards, this shows a boat. It shows about 50 yards on each side of the boat. The planer boards run off to the side of the boat. And you basically use very similar to what a downrigger release is on these. There's a couple different kinds of planer boards, and I'm going to talk about those here. But this kind of shows you the spread that you can get. So if you're fishing in shallow water and you want to spread out a bunch of lines, and you know you have a narrow boat, you can only run so many lines off the boat before they're going to get tangled. And so this is a way to kind of spread your selection. You're covering more water, and it's a very effective way to troll, say, on Willard Bay for wipers or walleye. And you can also use different lures on here. So you can use some lures that are going to dive deep, some lures that are going to be right up on the surface, so you can cover quite a section vertically as well as horizontally behind your boat. There's basically two big types of planers. There's what they call an inline planer, which are these little yellow ones in the upper left corner. And then there's the big planer boards that you could buy. They have some advantages and disadvantages, both kind. The inline planers are cheap, and you can you hook them onto your line, and then if a fish hits, the line pops out, and then the planer will either slide down and you have to fight it with the planer right in there. Other ones, people will put a snap on a line, so as you're reeling in, then you can unhook the little piece of planer board, which is about 8 inches long, and get it off your line, and then just fight the fish. The bigger planer boards, those are mounted to what they call a mast in the front of your boat. I think I'll have a picture here. And those run off to the side, and they're out there. And then you just send your releases down that main line that runs out to the planer board. And as a fish pops off, you just leave the planer board out there, and then you just add another release. And your releases just kind of stack up at the end of the line. And when you're done fishing for the day, you can bring it in, or when you run out of releases. These loops here that look like a paper clip, that kind of goes over the main line, and then the little pincher is where you put your regular line in to run back to your lure. And so that little loop, that just slides down the main line out to that big planer board, which is that big wooden one. A lot of times they sell these. They cost about $100 a piece, or sometimes even more. There are some plans online, and this is a homemade one. People will buy some wood, and then they have some threaded dowel or threaded rod, and they put them on there. And so you can get into making your own if you want to. So there's your inline planer board. Again, you let the line anywhere from 20 to 125 feet behind that planer board. The planer boards kind of run just a little bit behind the boat, not too far. They kind of track out there, and there's a left and a right one, so you want to make sure when you're buying them you don't buy two lefts, or you'll be very disappointed because they'll both be going off to one side of the boat. So they're specific onto what side of the boat, the port or the starboard side that you have. They're inexpensive. They're not particularly good in choppy water because they're only about 8 inches and maybe about 3 inches high. So on nice calm days, they absolutely work marvelously. But if you're going to be out and fishing in some choppy water, they're a little bit tougher to fish. And then a drawback is you have to fight the fish with that planer board in line, so you're kind of fighting the fish with that extra piece in there. If you're looking at solely to harvest meat, like for walleye, probably doesn't matter, but if you're out for sport and you just want to fight that fish, then it takes away a little bit of the fun. Yeah, on these inline ones, you could put a release on them, but the board will slide down, and so when you reel in, you get to a point where somebody in the boat or you have to pull your rod and then unhook it, and then you can fight the fish. So that red thing in the front of that board is the actual release, but then as it releases out of the red clip, then it's still snapped on, and it will slide back to, it looks like a swivel that they have there in front of that Rapala that's on there. Yeah, that's the big planer boards with the mast, and that is what I'm going to show you next right here. So this is another picture of the large planer boards. They're usually about 3 feet long and maybe about 8 to 10 inches high. They probably weigh, 20 or 30 pounds, but they're made out of wood or some kind of buoyant material, and they float. And then you need some kind of mast, and typically you run a mast in a seat base. If you have a seat base in the front of your boat, this is obviously for larger boats, and you would put that mast and mount it into that seat base, and then they have these big reels, and then it's usually some kind of braided nylon line or something. And this shows two reels, one for the port and one for the starboard side of the boat, and then that attaches right to that gigantic planer board. And once those are set, like I said, they run off to the side, and they're quite sizable, and they're good in choppy water. They're more expensive, but you can make your own. And the nice thing is your line is attached to a release, and then you clip it onto the main line coming off this mast, and it slides out. And you can let one slide all the way out to the board, and then you could let one slide maybe halfway out to the board, and then run some lines right beyond your boat. And when a fish releases, that actual release stays on the main line, and you're fighting it without fighting the board, and then the release just slides out to the board. You collect it when you're done fishing. This is a same picture. This is what he was just indicating, the mast in the front of the boat, and then it shows the lines, and then you're going back to your lures on those bigger planer boards. Again, this is a overhead view of the same thing. You got your planer board, you got your rope or your heavy braided line that holds that planer board, because there's a lot of drag on it. You can imagine something 30 or 40 pounds off to the side of your boat. And then it has three different rods, and a lot of people will use just a shower curtain hook and hook it around there, and then just put a rubber band as a release. So when the fish hits, it's going to rip that rubber band and pop the rubber band, and then that little shower ring is just going to go out there. So that ends up being a cheap way to make a release. They do have ones that have clips, and there's all kind of fancy ones. It's just about your thing. And this kind of shows some inline planers run off to one side of the boat. One of the things I wanted to talk about, and this is probably one of the most overlooked things on trolling that I've ever seen. I've been out fished with a couple of different guides. When you're setting your downrigger release, there's so many people that take the main line and just stick it in here and run it back. And I'm going to tell you that that's wrong, and you can tell me that I'm full of it, but what I do is I grab that line and put it around my finger and make three or four loops and then clip that loop in there. And the reason I have those loops is because then your line going up to your rod versus your line going out here, it's not going to slide through this release because there's several loops. And so you're going to get a positive hook set on that fish. And then when it pops out of there, the loops are just going to, it's going to come right out. And so that's such a simple thing to do. And it's one of the most important things when you're either using side planers or downriggers, because you want to load that rod up. And if you're loading the rod up, sometimes that line's going to want to slide through your release. But if you have several loops in there, it's not going to do that because you're fighting those twists. And so it's a very easy thing to do. You just grab it, loop it in there, and clip it in. So, up. Oh, on mechanical releases? You can if you want to, but you don't have to on those mechanical releases. They're a little bit different. It works a lot better with the pinch releases. Yep. Okay, and then finally, the flat line trolling, you know, you're limited to about 30 feet of water, low cost, lure action is real easy to control by speed of the boat. It works best in the early and late season for cold water fish because those fish can be anywhere in the water column. You don't have a thermocline set up. So right now, trolling at, for say, Bear Lake or Strawberry, you could be in there in 5 to 15 feet of water trolling parallel to shore, and cutthroat will still be there because the water's still cold. So it works really good in these early and late seasons. And then it's easily combined with other trolling methods. A lot of times you could drop downriggers down deep. You could run a couple pieces of lead core, maybe halfway in between, and then run some flat lines right out the back. So you can combine it with other methods. And then finally, diver trolling. You have what they call dipsy divers. It's easier to use than downriggers and planing boards. Some of them can get directions off the boat. It does require a pretty heavy rod because you're fighting that diver. And this is a picture of a dipsy diver. You could set it so it could run off to the port or the starboard or straight down. And it does get you down there. And then there's all kind of neat little charts and everything that are available with dipsy divers when you buy them on the back of the package, and it allow you to get down if you don't have the ability to use a downrigger. And so this is one of the dipsy diver depth charts that, you know, they're showing going down on a jet diver, which is another brand, going down to easily to 50 feet. But again, you need a pretty stout rod for this, and it puts a lot of strain on the rod, but when the fish bites, the thing kind of pops open, and you still have that dipsy diver in there, but you're not really fighting it. So it's not too bad. It's a good alternative to downriggers. Lead core line, typically marked in 10-yard increments. You can control your depth quite well by letting out more or less line. It's speed sensitive, it's low cost, but you only can get down about 60 feet. In some of these waters, you want to fish deeper than that. And then there's your multiple trolling with flat lines, either divers or lead core, and then downriggers. So you can get a lot of lines behind the boat and keep them out without getting tangled. Bunch of different trolling spoons if you're out there using spoons. Just thought I'd throw some of the ones up that I use for kokanee. And then finally, the end of this is troll where you have the best chance of success. Learn how to use all the bells and whistles that you heard about earlier on your electronics. It's going to pay dividends. You're going to learn to read those, find out where the fish are. You could troll all day in a big abyss where there's no fish, but if you learn how to read those electronics and find the fish, target those fish. And then there's underwater bars, roads, humps, structures, trees and points. And then finally, look for active fish on the sonar. A lot of times you could see your downrigger ball tracking and you'll see fish coming up to the downrigger ball and going down. Those are active fish. They're looking to see what's going on. If you're trolling over fish and they're not even looking at the downrigger, you're going to want to move either shallower or deeper. So look for the active fish. Watch them sonars, and if they're coming up and looking at the ball, they're going to do that to your lure too. And so in summary, I hope I've covered everything. I've talked a little bit. I left out dodgers. That's a good display in the back. And so, and if there's any questions, I'll be happy to take those. Yes? Personally, I like to fish just above where the lures or where the fish are showing up on the sonar, because those active fish are going to be searching and they're going to come up and look at it. If you're down below them, these fish are, most of the time, they're going to look up for what they're feeding on. Very little do they go down and hit stuff. So if you're seeing fish, say, at 30 feet and they're all at 30 feet, I'll try to troll like at maybe 28 feet and make them come up. Sometimes if you're down at 35 feet and the fish are at 30, you're not going to catch anything. So it really pays to watch that sonar. I can't believe how tied they are together, but you really have to pay attention to that. Oh, one more question. Yes, there's commercial molds available for making downrigger weights, and you could do a little Google search online. Most of them are out of the Pacific Northwest for commercial fishermen. That's where I found them. A good place to start is a place called Seattle Marine, but there's other stores out there. My pancake weight, I made my own mold, and I got the, I used candle bases, believe it or not, that you find at like Michaels or Hobby Lobby, and I put two of them together and made a piece of wood that goes over them and then drilled a hole in them. And I seal it with like aluminum tape, and then I just pour it in. And for the fin, I use a thing that you would use on a piece of like a truss or whatever, one of those mending plates. And then once I'm done, I have one up here, I cover it with like some of the Plasti Dip or something like that, so it doesn't mark up your boat too bad. Yes? Yep. If you're working your downriggers, it is a good idea to have your life jacket on, because you're leaning over the side of your boat. There was a fellow that drowned up at Bear Lake here a few years back, and there arguably he was all by himself, so no one really knows what happened, but he was trolling that day and it was in the cold weather. He could have easily fell over. And once you fall over, if you don't believe me, if you're out there in a nice warm summer day and you're in fairly shallow water, jump out of your boat and then try to get back in without anyone helping you. It's difficult. One more question. Good question. Where am I getting my lead from? You could buy it. If you have a gas station that is a good friend of yours, you can go to them and melt down tire weights. It's not the best lead, but for making downrigger balls, it works quite well. I wouldn't use it to make jig heads, but for downrigger balls, it would work.
Thanks, Scott. Yeah, you can tell Scott has a real vast knowledge of what he's presenting here, and I'm sure that he'd be happy to share more of that knowledge after we're done here. So to wrap this up, I just want to cover a few of I call them favorite trolling waters here, but for most part, I tried to steer away from those that everybody knows. I mean, we talk about Strawberry, we talk about Flaming Gorge, we talk about Bear Lake, but there's lots of other waters in this state where trolling can be a great technique. So I asked all of our regional managers to send me a list of two or three waters in their regions and what species they troll for when, you know, people do fish there. So this should be pretty quick in terms of a presentation, but it'll give you an idea of just the variety of waters that's available. And by no means is this list exhaustive. It's just some of the better waters in each region. So starting in the northern region, Willard Bay. Great water to troll in for hybrid striped bass, wipers, and walleye. Pine View, talked a little bit about, but for tiger muskie, not a technique that most people think of when they're fishing for tiger muskie, but it's an effective way to fish for them. Hiram Rockport and East Canyon, you catch brown trout, rainbow trout. Yeah, it's actually an external parasite that gets on them in the summertime. It doesn't cause any human health issues. It mostly affects the trout because the trout gets super stressed when the water's warm. What happens at East Canyon, again, it's a reservoir that suffers from water quality issues, but the top layer gets too warm. The bottom layer has no oxygen in it, so all the fish get mashed up into a small area in the center of the water column. When they do that, they become really stressed and they become susceptible to infection from that parasite. It's called Lernia. Pardon me? Jordanelle is a little bit different. It's not as productive, so it doesn't, that middle range of water is much bigger, so you don't have the crowding issue there that would cause those fish to be as stressed. Does Jordanelle have a lot of chubs? Jordanelle has a fair number of chubs that are all about 10 to 14 inches long. What we don't have, apparently, are small chubs that used to provide a forage in there. And I'd be happy to spend a lot more time talking about Jordanelle. Just spent the last 3 years figuring out where we're going up there. Okay. So this is a picture from Rockport. This fish was based on the emblem on her hat there, which probably came out of a gill net, but nonetheless, it's a fish that is certainly available to the anglers up there. So you can see they have really nice fish. So Northeast region, this is the office that's based in Vernal. So of course you have Flaming Gorge for lake trout, rainbow trout, and kokanee salmon. Everybody should be familiar with the gorge. If you aren't, you need to be. It's one of the best fisheries in the state. Starvation Reservoir for rainbow trout. People that fish Starvation Reservoir, I love fishing Starvation Reservoir. It's one of my favorite. They call them the rainbow out there, Starvation Steelhead, or Starvation Steelies. 22-inch rainbow out there that weighs 3.5 pounds is hardly even worth putting a post on Facebook about. It's just that common. So they also have a nice walleye in there that you can pick up trolling. Steinecker Reservoir for rainbow trout. And then a couple for smaller boats are East Park Reservoir, Moon Lake, and Current Creek. Good places if you've got a little, 12-foot or 14-foot boat and you don't feel comfortable putting it out on Starvation where the wind can get pretty good, go to one of these other places. Another good place to go normally is Matt Warner Reservoir on Diamond Mountain. However, it has some water level issues, so maybe next year when we get some water back in the reservoir. Okay, and this is one of those Starvation Steelheads. That's actually a little small one there. I've caught them 18 to 22 inches out of there, and pretty commonly. Okay, and these are a couple of kokanee out of Flaming Gorge. And there's a Flaming Gorge lake trout. He's long arming that fish a little bit. He's got his arms out like this, but you know, the bottom line is that that's a nice fish regardless of how long your arms are. Yes. What happened to the brown trout in Flaming Gorge? You can still catch brown trout up to about 8 to 10 pounds in the inflow area. You know, it's a Black's Fork and the Green River inflows. What mostly happened to Flaming Gorge is that it's 40 years old and it's not the same reservoir that it was 40 years ago. Well, actually, it's 50 years old now, so. Okay, Central Region. This is our office out of Springville. Strawberry, again, we know. Kokanee salmon, rainbow trout, cutthroat trout. Rainbow trout at Strawberry, are typically in shallower water. They're not going to be as readily accessible to trolling. Most people will pick up one or two rainbow when they're trolling for cutthroat, however. So if you're going up there to troll, figure you're not going to target rainbow. You're targeting cutthroat, and then perhaps you'll catch a rainbow or two. Deer Creek Reservoir, especially in the spring and fall, Deer Creek is on fire. It's a great place to fish. Rainbow trout in the 17 to 18, couple 19-inch fish come out of there. Just really fat, nice fish. Jordanelle Reservoir for rainbow trout. Jordanelle, those of you who may have fished it in the past few years, has been experiencing some problems. Again, reservoir's aging, it's changing. We are, however, in fact, moving into a whole new management plan with Jordanelle Reservoir that we've been working on for quite a while now, and we'll be putting that out to the public. And we hope to really turn that place around and make it a destination fishery that it once was. Okay, here's a cutthroat from Strawberry. The best month to fish for kokanee at Strawberry or at Flaming Gorge, without a doubt, is the month of June. And at Strawberry, the way you find a kokanee during the month of June is you stand on the dock and watch where all the other boats are fishing. Okay, Southeastern Region, this is where I used to work. This is obviously the best region in the state. Joes Valley Reservoir, Splake, and there's our buddies at Tiger Muskie again. Splake up to about 15, 18 pounds. Tiger Muskie are the biggest one I've heard of coming out of there is 48 inches. We half expect to see a state record catch and release or catch and keep fish come out of there in the next year or so, which would be 51 or 52 inches. Great, great fishery. Huntington North Reservoir, small. It's only 300 acres. It's right by the town of Huntington State Park. Really nice state park there. Rainbow trout up to 22 inches. We put rainbow trout in there with the idea that it was going to be a winter fishery, just for through fall, winter, and spring, three-season fishery. For whatever reason, they managed to survive the summer down there in that shallow reservoir, and you can get some really nice rainbow out of there. Hybrid striped bass wipers, again, 7-8 pound wipers, doing really good. Month of September is a great time to fish for them down there. Electric Lake, cutthroat trout, tiger trout, kokanee salmon. Saw a bunch of pictures from the kokanee up there. They've only been in there 3 years now, and Saw some pictures from last year, 18, 19 inch kokanee, 2 to 3 pounds. Yes, sir, in the back.
What kind of a boat ramp do you have?
It's single lane. Depending on the water level, it will challenge you to back it down because it can be a long back. There's no, you can turn around up at the top, but then you just back down. As far as I know, I have never seen the water level drop below the end of the ramp. Doesn't mean it doesn't happen. I just personally haven't witnessed that. That's for Electric Lake, which is a really terrific little fishery. If you get a chance, go fishing there. Is there a boat size restriction on Electric Lake? No, there is not, but the reservoir itself is a small, narrow canyon reservoir. You're not going to want to take a big boat up there, and you're definitely not going to get on plane. You know, I would fish, you know, with a 25 horse or 30 horse would be just fine, but, you know, you put your inboard, outboard, or whatever on there, you're going to be pushing it. Okay, here's a couple of the hybrid striped bass out of Huntington North. Again, great, great little fishery. It's the only place I know of that you can catch a 7 or 8 pound wiper, a 6 to 7 pound largemouth, a 20 pound channel catfish, and a 20 inch rainbow all on the same trip. And there's one of my Joe's tiger muskies. That may have been the first one that exceeded 40 inches. This one is from Joe's Valley. Southern region, Fish Lake, lake trout, splake, rainbow trout, kokanee salmon. Kokanee have been in there just a little more than a year now. Last fall, they were 11 to 12 inches. They should be pushing 15, 16 inches by this fall. Lake trout, we all know about lake trout from Fish Lake, can be huge. Splake also, rainbow, do really well there. Lake Powell, if you'd asked me 5 years ago about trolling at Lake Powell, I would have told you, nah, doesn't seem like a good idea. And then I spent some time with Wayne Gustavison, the godfather of Lake Powell, and he told me that yeah, fishing, trolling for stripers, great technique. And of course, walleye have really started to come on, especially in the upper end of the reservoir. So there's a picture of Fish Lake. There's a splake from Fish Lake. There's Lake Powell, walleye, couple stripers with, there's the old man of the sea himself, Wayne. He just celebrated his 40th anniversary of working on Lake Powell, by the way. Any questions? Yes, sir. Yeah. Yeah, Panguitch Lake can be really good. Like I said, this is far from being an exhaustive list. I just asked them for top two or three waters. These are the ones that they sent me. But yeah, Panguitch, again, really terrific fishery for tiger trout, cutthroat trout, and rainbow. Yes? Where do we post the seminars on the DNR website? The best place to find them I'm not a YouTube kind of guy, but if you go to YouTube and you query for the Utah Wildlife Resources, you'll get a list of all our YouTube videos, and these will be there. Okay, We've got a drawing for two fishing trips to Strawberry. So, Scott, would you grab the bucket, please?
Hello, everyone. I'm ready to go fishing here. It's exciting. Hey, the reason I'm up here is I'm the president of the Strawberry Anglers Association. We're one of the co-sponsoring groups behind today's seminar. My name is Ronald Dunn. What we have are two fishing trips sponsored by the Strawberry Anglers Association for the date August 13th. That's a Saturday, whoever the two selectees are. I also brought a number of handouts, most of which are gone or in the back. There are two displays of some of the fishing techniques to be used for trolling at Strawberry Reservoir. Lastly, I brought some hats along if you'd like to purchase one of those. Most are similar to what I have on. So let's do the drawing.